The story starts with the idea of traveling, the idea of getting out of the classroom, the idea of the, you know, when it comes to the pedagogy behind the trip is to get hands-on, get your hands dirty, test the waters, and get some experiential learning under your belt before you sort of head out into the real world. And San Francisco has proven to do that so far.
Careless and free on this road. Yeah, well, my sins are bound to me, I was told.
So my impetus about this trip was just to, essentially there was a couple of them, and that was one to travel, get out of the classroom, and bring people down to be in a city and be in a learning environment where they can see these processes that they're reading about play out in real life. So once the trip was established and we had approval and the idea was sort of solidified, the exciting part for me was to recruit this team, and I'm really glad that Jonathan Hughes and Sherry Enns came on board, and I really feel like it was a perfect collaboration between the physical elements and the hazard management and the earthquakes, particularly around a very seismic active region, with the planning and the cultural and the human side of things.
When they told me about this idea to come down to San Francisco and this idea of combining public transit with urban planning and within a city of seismic risk. And I thought, well, that sounds pretty good. And he had mentioned that Sherry Enns would be out as another person on the trip, and I thought that would just be great. I like both of those folks, so that was intriguing.
Over the last year, I was on sabbatical, and while I was away, Mike was doing our teaching most of my courses. And I was really excited to be invited on this trip so that I could learn from him, and especially when I knew Jonathan would also be on the trip. I thought the synergy between the three of us would work really well. So it was an honor to be asked.
My name is Alana Matthews.
Kelly Kling.
My name is Janae Enns.
Caitlin Middlestead.
I'm Sarah.
My name is Amelia.
I'm Alicia.
Brittany.
My name is Ariel.
Ashley.
Desmond.
Luke.
My name is Dylan Anderson.
I'm Devin.
Hey, so I'm Ivan Sidhu.
What's up? My name's Mike.
Well, as you know, our department is a combination of human geography and physical geography, and so we have a mix of students that are bringing different backgrounds to the table here and some different interests.
I wanted to go to San Francisco because I'm majoring in global development right now with a minor in geography.
It's a chance to put what I've practically learned in university into perspective.
I really like the earthquakes and the physical side, and the transportation system's amazing.
I'm interested in sort of a little bit of planning. I'm interested in all three aspects, and so I haven't really decided where my focus really lies, and so that's why I was interested. I was hoping to kind of feel that out and see what kind of activities kind of combine those three aspects, so that's why I was kind of excited to go.
I was interested to see how they would begin to bring the three themes, if you will, the earthquake risk, the transportation, issues in terms of planning, design, and then formulate or begin to think about what makes them happy in the context of a place.
I hope to learn a little bit comparatively to Vancouver and sort
yeah,
of that kind of
just
stuff.
Basically how the city functions compared to Vancouver, I would say. How much, just to see if it's easier to walk around the city and, you know, get around, where in Vancouver it's kind of a pain in the ass.
As a human geographer, as a transportation planner, I'm hoping that students are able to really understand the symbiotic relationship between the urban environment and the physical environment. Cities are really just a pure physical manifestation of what humans are, right? And humans' ideas and how to best live in a city in a most sustainable fashion. So this trip was an opportunity for us to experience a city without the automobile and without ever getting into a car. And that's exactly what we've done over the past 6 days, is refrain from getting in a car. So we've taken transit, we've taken regional rail, the BART system, we've taken Muni, which is the local rail system, we've taken a ferry, we've been on bicycles over the Golden Gate Bridge, and we've done a lot of walking over the last 6 days. I think it was clocked at something like 120 kilometers of walking, and that's not even including all the other modes of transportation we've done. So being in San Francisco, I knew that the transportation system was such that it was efficient. It had this traditional aspect to it. It's very well connected. You overlap that with increase in cycling mode share, pedestrianism. Mix that in with a North American city, and you get San Francisco.
These are sort of the Dutch-style three-speed bikes that are most comfortable to ride on for everyone. You know, the city of Vancouver uses the AAA as an indicator of all ages and abilities cycling. And this is what North American cities are trying to get towards, is more of a European style, European approach to everyday life, to everyday cycling, not just mammals, as I heard the acronym the other day.
Middle-aged
men in Lycra.
Hey, I take offense at that.
I also wear Lycra. But these, I don't have to put my Lycra on, right? We can hop on these right now and be around. Three speeds, you know,
nice seats.
Totally fine.
It was cool going over the bridge, though. It was definitely, definitely very cool, especially like as the sun was setting.
It was nice that cyclists were on one side,
yeah.
Pedestrians on the other. No conflict.
Nice little leisurely bike ride. So
we're looking at some of the top-priced real estate in America right now. Side mansions in Sausalito. However, we were discussing vulnerability and hazard proneness of these locations since they're right on the seaside. type of earthquake, shaking, mudslide. You wonder how, you know, what type of foundation these places have. So, but it's a lovely little seaside village. We just biked from the Golden Gate Bridge, or all the way from Pier 43, Pier 49, over the Golden Gate Bridge to Sausalito, and we've arrived, and now we're on the ferry back to return our bikes and back to the Green Tortoise. So to me, this city is a reflection of how people want to live in dense environments, and that's they don't necessarily want to have they don't necessarily want to feel the need to own a car, and you really get that sense in here that you don't have to.
Down in, we're in San Francisco, we're down in North Beach, we're heading to Union Square, and today is International Official Parking Day, and this is a rogue setup, taking away a couple parking spaces and creating this lovely parklet, essentially, that we're sitting in enjoying reading our Economist.
This is Parking Day. We're trying to use recycled materials and just material we can find anywhere. Sometimes people might consider it as trash, and we use it to set up this open space to serve for the local community and create a more like interaction between people. Like this is a working like financial kind of district, and people. It's really hard for them to find open space during lunchtime to hang out and sit down, have a coffee, or have their lunch. So we're trying to reuse the parking spot.
We're gonna go meet Philip J. Dreyfus, local celebrity from San Francisco, talk about his book, Our Better Nature.
What's that about?
It's about how the city of San Francisco came to be and you know, how it changed into a booming metropolis in only a few decades.
Who we met on Monday and was couldn't have been a better historical context for San Francisco, as he's an environmental historian, and he was able to tell us how San Francisco came to be, right from the Native Americans through the colonization. Of the Bay Area to something it is today, which is a very metropolitan, cosmopolitan city.
I only started to think of myself as an environmental historian, I guess about 15 years ago. Because when I went to grad school and did my my PhD, there really wasn't such a thing.
What are the big issues for San Fran as we look towards 2050, 2100?
Well, I know that San Francisco as a city is thinking about the issue of sea level rise. I think that this is too recent a problem in terms of city awareness for there to be a plan in place. I assume at some point there will have to be.
Well, thanks a lot, Philip.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thanks. Thank you.
We couldn't ask for a better classroom today.
No, and thank you all for coming. That's right, you are in San Francisco's banana belt here.
Yeah, you answered my question, which is cool. I got to learn a little bit about the dichotomy between what works in some cities and what doesn't, and why certain cities have grown the way they have based on their history and the economic situation in whichever city. And my question was how San Francisco can become such a great dense city and livable, but then to the south you have such an opposite in Los Angeles, where it's sprawled out and not dense.
Auto dependent.
Auto dependent, yeah.
And the interesting part of the interesting answer there was the reality that some of these other cities like New York and San Fran and others, or Chicago is the other example he used, were founded by lots of immigrants. Hmm. And LA was a city that was really founded by prosperous Midwestern Americans that were looking for their retirement area.
I gotta go add more money to it.
So I was happy to see that, and being from Vancouver, I was happy to see that Vancouver, I thought, was doing a great job in comparison to a bigger city like San Francisco. San Francisco is about 850,000 people. Vancouver is about a third of the size. So there's a big population difference in these two cities. And honestly, I think Vancouver has set a foundation with regards to being sustainable, being resilient, being active, they set a foundation that's better than San Francisco has done, I think. But at the same time, I think that Vancouver has elements to learn from San Francisco, and I think the transit system is one of them. And the options that people have to get around this city are very seamless, especially amongst the suburbs and the regional rail, where really Vancouver and all the municipalities south of the Fraser, Abbotsford, Langley, Surrey, Chilliwack, there's nothing out there, right? So for us, and I know a lot of the students have commented on the fact that this place is really well connected. Outside of San Francisco, there's a lot of sprawl, but you can get there by public transit, and you don't necessarily have to hop in a car to make all your trips.
We were going to meet with planners at Oakland City Hall, and we had met as a group just outside City Hall, and then we're heading in, and Sarah just misjudged when she jumped down, and she does a lot of sports, and I guess her ankles are a little bit weak, and she collapsed. And all I can say is that she was in a lot of pain, and it was distressful to watch her, let alone for what she experienced. Mm-hmm.
All of a sudden, here's Sarah, who is now dependent on a wheelchair, you know. And so I've read about this exercise, you know, able people putting themselves in situations where they have to experience a city that really isn't set up very well to accommodate people with mobility issues, such as wheelchairs or walkers or elderly. And I have to say, you know, with San Francisco's topography and the amount of hills that are around and the age of the city and the sidewalks and whatnot, there are some very dangerous situations that...
I would refer to them as challenging.
But I think it probably was a really informative, positive aspect mm-hmm. after that.
As it turns out.
Just in terms of looking at the city now through the eyes of someone with a disability. Mm-hmm. And all students really pitched in and helped. I think it really added.
So I've been to San Francisco a couple times within the context of thinking about earthquakes and the idea to bring students down here and introduce them to this city and some of its seismic history and some of the risk that's here seemed like a fun idea. It's an area that has suffered past earthquakes, the 1906 San Francisco earthquake being a substantial earthquake for this region and really the nation in terms of its impact. And then other earthquakes like the Loma Prieta earthquake, which happened in 1989, where there was a lot of fatalities and collapsed infrastructure. So because of these known past events, loss of life and infrastructure, the city has done a lot to fortify bridges, to fortify building codes, to understand the earthquake hazard.
city of Hayward, or the subdivision of Hayward, which is kind of lies right over a fault line. So basically, we're in the City Hall building because it was reconstructed to very good earthquake standards.
Ultimately, completely condemned building, can't live in it. So if you guys want to go up there and take a look, and then we can walk around the building some and look for some of the evidence of the aseismic creep.
I see some crack.
Although I don't know why. They upgrade everything else, it seems like, so why can't they upgrade the City Hall? Like, why build a new one? And I don't know.
Cost too much, maybe?
You think you'd save money upgrading it? I don't know. I guess it would probably collapse.
Having the idea of building codes in place, public awareness, public outreach, public involvement is really key, and I think San Francisco is probably in the lead of about any other city.
The concept that you might want to take away is there's a thing called a model code. And the model code that we use, and I believe you guys use it in Vancouver, British Columbia, it's the International Building Code. You guys want to see the basement?
Yeah.
All right. So we basically make sure that the buildings that we build or alter comply with current codes. Essentially, the whole building is sitting on these little, there's a low friction surface there between this lower plate and this upper plate. So when the earthquake happens, the building's gonna slide back and forth. Upstairs in the plaza, there'll be a breakaway where the tiles are to allow the building to just move freely back and forth. And then if you look around, you'll see shock absorbers to help control that lateral movement. And they're just giant shock absorbers, just like in your car. And they're attached to the portion of the building that's going down into the earth, and then up to the portion of the building that's actually gonna move side to side.
We are a city or a collection of communities that are still dealing with a seismic risk. And so we're coming from an area that has that as part of our overall urban knowledge and plan. Okay. And so in that sense, if we had been coming from, say, I don't know, Saskatchewan or something, they might have said, okay, well, you're not coming from a seismically active area, and maybe he figures, because we're coming from Vancouver, we're all pretty aware of seismic risk, and we know the big one's coming, sort of thing. Yeah.
Earthquakes are funny because they don't happen all the time, right? They happen, sort of like a hundred year flood type of thing. But this story needs to get told so that it doesn't repeat itself.
For my skill sets here, I was hoping to introduce them to some of the science of earthquakes and introduce them to some of the colleagues I know at the U.S. Geological Survey, and in hopes that they could understand the science better and then apply that to urban planning, at least in terms of the complexity of what that causes in terms of thinking about social issues and planning issues and transportation issues within the seismically active zone.
That's what a seismic instrument is. We have a sensor. You can record acceleration. We've had calculus. You know that you can go from acceleration by integration to velocity. You can go from velocity to displacement. If you haven't had the calculus, don't worry about it. But there are different sensors that measure different things.
We can do things here in the lab. In this machine, I actually make small earthquakes, so I can make earthquakes, manipulate parameters, and try to understand the physics of how earthquakes start, what happens when the earthquake is happening, the rupture is propagating along the fault, a lot of energy has been released, where does that go? How does the earthquake stop? We're having this accelerating creep, and eventually the slip will just go unstable. And there we go. So that's like a magnitude -2 earthquake.
Well, 9.3.
No, like minus two.
To see them learn and to think about how I might be able to translate some of this back into my classroom back at UFE to, again, get students to think more about the region they live in and the seismic risk.
I've seen them around. We were on the Embarcadero where we rented the bikes and rode around. There were some tsunami evacuation routes. The way to go if all of a sudden we do have an earthquake siren go off that you'd want to move away. And it's not so much of the tsunami that we expect from subduction zones with a lot of vertical displacement, but when you've got shifting and shaking, you can create sish waves that you sort of think about like maybe in a bathtub or something, where if you shift rapidly, then everything just tends to kind of rock a bit. Mm-hmm. It's not so much...
So
yeah.
A bit smaller then?
Yeah, probably smaller, but still.
It's
going to
do damage, especially in Sausalito.
and you look at all these boats and the expensive infrastructure that's around these ports and marinas and stuff, and you could have some damage associated with that for sure.
Oh, I'm passionate about the idea of learning in a place and exploring with the students. But I think probably the aspect that I could add some value in terms of student learning was on the social justice issue. I also do work as it relates to homelessness more in the region where we are, in Abbotsford, and with the issues in San Francisco being 6,000, 7,000 people plus each night on the street, I thought it would be really exciting to look at a dynamic city that works well for some, but really isn't a good place for so many. So I think that was the main way I thought I could contribute to the student learning. I was really interested on our first day when we met with the nonprofit group that has converted a large bus, a form of transportation, into a showers and toilet, I guess, for homeless people, the idea of mobile personal services. And I was intrigued in terms of trying to understand how that worked and how the idea evolved and just the energy behind the idea.
For us, the shower is so important. Like, that's where the impact is. It's not just cleaning up the streets, it's cleaning up the person. This right here is the door on the side of the bus. So you enter, and here again, you have the sink. This is the sky, as I mentioned. You have a little hair dryer, and then this little room, this is a changing area here, and this is a toilet and a shower back there. We operate on a just flat foundation of respect. We believe that the dignity doesn't just come from the nice facilities, but from the human interaction. So it's about looking at people in the eye, knowing their names, being genuinely friendly. Like, we're not dealing with case management here. We're not in the dregs. We're not working with people over time and all these things, but we are seeing people over time. We have so many regulars at this point, and it's about making them feel valued and part of this.
If even one person sleeps outside, potentially you haven't done enough to say, you know, to make a value judgment on could a city do more or do better or do differently. It's systemic in terms of the issues.
They didn't want the students of this college to be inspired by the building, so they decided to make it as bland as possible so that they would draw design influences from elsewhere and from other environments.
Encourage you to think about what a city would look like if it was more sustainable, or if we use the word justice. If a city, if justice was the frame of reference through which policy was shaped and created, and in that regard, what would be some of the questions we might ask about its access to open space and nature, I should say access to affordable housing, just work, opportunities for work, restoration, transportation networks that are more equitable, that is, as much money invested in public transit as in freeways, for example. So are we committed to better environments? And if we are, is technology one way to help shape and understand cities, certainly to measure change and impact of plans? And many people would say planning is the art of which geography is the science. So this idea that a lot of your geographic background, whether it's physical or human, is really important in terms of understanding the city, but as well shaping policy. I started thinking about city as really a dance. And don't worry, I won't dance.
But the choreographed city, how does it all flow together? And I think some of you talk about the just city. You have authors that reference happy city, the good city, the equitable city. Yesterday, we started learning about the resilient city, and that can be used in many different contexts. And a term that's actually become more popular is just sustainable cities or just sustainabilities.
My family, first family dog's name was T-Square.
T-Square?
He was a basset hound.
Aww.
T-Square.
Your dad was definitely an architect.
Because he was an architect.
It's interesting to compare and contrast squares elsewhere with what we're observing or where the students are walking today. For example, if one looked at the square, and we understand that a lot of North American cities, the goal was to emulate European cities, even Paris in this case, that we're missing some of the elements of the square that add, I guess, dimension or depth to the square. So while we have a functional shopping area and lots of programmed activity in the square, what we don't have is the church or the common local fruit stands or the other aspects that are very much part of the European square in terms of it being a more integrated, more democratic place with all groups of people. This is a much more exclusive space in that regard, but at the same time a space that works and functions much more so than, say, Robson Square or other places we might be more familiar with.
Were some students playing a big sort of human scale version of Jenga in a public space, and this was all being recorded, and people began to gather around as they were playing the game, and then as it all turns out, the game's over, people leave, and there's a baby left stranded. No parent around, no parents returning. And now these students are sitting there saying, there's a baby there. And the interesting thing is, because this sort of playtime event with the students was being filmed, the whole event of the baby being abandoned was filmed. Mm-hmm. And so that led to a notification to police and a police investigation and the footage being of value to the police.
I think I've ever thought about
that. And so there's a lot of lower level crimes that happen here, but not a lot of it rises to felony, you know, felony conduct. But I do get a lot of retail theft. A lot of people come to Macy's, a lot of people, that's their only way of surviving is going to Macy's, taking stuff off the shelves, and then going and selling it. Actually, where you guys were at 7th and Market is a place where people buy and sell stolen goods a lot. So if I'm like that guy who was on heroin, and I can shoplift something, I can go sell it there, and then I can go buy my drugs, and I've made it through another day, so. They do homeless counts, and I can't remember what the last count is.
It was 10,000. Yeah,
I was going to say between 6 and 10 or something like that.
7,000, but I mean, it could be up to 50. It's so hard to count.
Right. And it's something the city puts a lot of resources into combating, and there must not be an easy answer, or it would be gone with all the money that the city puts into it. So I know it happens. A lot of the people you see here are homeless, but also the city has a lot of resources and does a lot of work in housing and trying to house homeless people. But it's a big problem, and I think some homeless people, like I've talked to, and they don't feel safe in shelters. They don't like some of them like being free. They like being out, you know, in the open air. They don't like being confined and restricted like that. So it's not every homeless, you know, homeless people are people, and no, they're not all the same. And there's all kinds of different reasons why they're homeless. And some of them, I can't say, they probably don't want to be homeless, but for some of them, it's not as bad as probably we would think it is.
me is one student, well, Brittany said, I thought I'd see more happiness here. And I wonder, you know, at some level, can, when you see so many people are disenfranchised or suffering, can the city be happy? And if so, what would that mean, or what should it mean? So this whole issue of social justice and equitable city, I think, is really probably today's incident brings it back in many ways to where we started.
As you recall, one of the books that the students were to read or had a choice to read was by the title Happy City.
Yeah.
And it's about San Francisco as a happy city. And I think that some of the students' impression was, is it really?
Yeah.
The book title has that, mm-hmm. but we saw a lot of unhappiness here.
Mm-hmm.
We experienced the good, the bad, and the ugly in San Francisco. You know, what really makes that place tick on a 24-hour basis? And then take that information and that story that exists in San Francisco and apply elements to Abbotsford. And I think that's where the students will have learnt the most. And I think the students will have this wonderful experience documented on film to go back and revisit, and really the opportunity to know how to learn in different places and then again bring it back and apply it to their own lives and their own cities and how to make those both of those better.
All good. Has fluids and things like that, more than that amount, just like 4.5 ounces or something. Oh, okay. You want to check that out. I know you're probably gonna miss me when I'm gone.
Your education than just sitting in the classroom, because you really can't understand what you're learning until you actually get your boots on the ground in that place.
Really kind of gave me insight of what a professional degree or career in planning would look like.
Just being able to go hop on a bike and rip all over the city, not having to deal with the traffic, not having to walk all over the place with all the big hills, you know, it was just kind of a nice thing that I wish Vancouver would associate with their city as well.
The bike share and all that stuff, that's amazing, and I wish we had it.
It was an easy sell because San Francisco is a city on the West Coast that is it's facing many issues, many problems that cities around North America do, except it has a lot of wonderful elements to it. And since we've been down here, we've been witnessing a whole bunch of those things.
I know you're probably gonna miss me when I'm gone.
instead of on the ball.